Morning. Welcome to Higher Hope Church. Why don't you stand and worship with us this morning?
If you look at the Savior, Welcome to Higher Hope. Go ahead and have a seat. I just want to welcome you here to worship with us. And really, we do want you to turn your eyes on Jesus. He is the center of what we do here. He is the one we're following as we are his disciples and as we want to learn more about him and what he has planned for us. And so as we worship together today, we hope that you are fixing your eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Because it will change us. Just a few things as we start this morning. One is, if you're new with us, if this is your first time, we want to welcome you here. We have a special gift for you just to let you know who we are as a church. There's some small gifts that kind of share with you our core values, what we value here at Higher Hope. And so you can pick that up at the Welcome Center if you want to do that. If you're here with us all the time, again, we want to welcome you here as well. I do want to mention the connection card, and I mentioned this mainly because I want to be praying for you. And so there's lots of things you can fill out and get information on, but I want to especially mention if there's something that you're going through, if you need someone to kind of check in on you, or you want something to meet with somebody about something that you're facing, don't do life alone, because it is hard, and we are designed to do life together. And so at minimum, let me pray for you. And so we have these connection cards. Fill it out. You can also use the app if you're more want to be more tech savvy. We have an app that you can do that on. These connection cards, you can hand them to me. There's some baskets in the back that you can use for that. We are in the middle of this Higher Hope 15 series. And so again, if you haven't been with us, we're celebrating 15 years. We started 15 years ago at the Warplane Museum. And moved to Broad Street School, and 15 years later, we're here, and it's more about less about the locations we've been, and more about the story that God has written for us that we're trying to celebrate. And so we're sharing throughout the whole series what we're about, and next week is really the culmination of that, and we'll talk a little bit more about that later, but we're glad that you're celebrating with us, and we're just going to pray and ask God to be powerful and speak. We want this to be a house of prayer. We do have at the foot of the cross, if you need a place to go to this morning, you really want to present something to Jesus, cast your burdens to him, feel free to go to the cross. But let's pray together as we worship. Heavenly Father, as we come in this morning, I don't know what everyone is walking in with, the baggage that they may have, or whether it's some good things they're celebrating or some difficult things they're facing, but you do. And you have drawn them here for a purpose. And I believe that you want to speak, you want to show up in their life in some way. So God, I pray your spirit be working in us, speaking to us, that our hearts will be willing to listen, that we will soften ourselves and slow ourselves down enough to really hear your voice. And all these things that we're carrying in, I pray that we place at your feet because we need you. We need your grace. We need your wisdom. We want to follow you in every step that we take. And so, God, I pray that you be powerful in our time this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Just stand with us as we continue to worship this morning. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee.
my heart. It is thine own. It shall be thy royal throne. Take my love.
Yeah.
there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
All right, go ahead and have a seat. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to Ephesians chapter 2, but I'm going to start Genesis 1:1 this morning. And it's the beginning of the Bible, the very first book, very first verse that is actually kind of foundational to all the rest. And you may have heard it before, maybe have it memorized. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. You know, and that picture of God creating. All right, just sit in that for a second, of God the artist. One of the very first characteristics we see of God is that he's creative, that he is a designer, that he's a builder, that he's a cultivator, that he made the world and the heavens and the stars and the most beautiful places on earth and your favorite place, the beach or the mountains, the diversity of a desert and a tropical rainforest, and he created the diversity of the animals, that they're still discovering fish and other species, and that he created the hugeness of our galaxies. That God is creative, and there are things like people are still discovering that God made a long time ago. In the beginning, God created, and there's such beauty to that, such amazing wonder sometimes if we could just enjoy what God created. Now, keep going with that thought process. There's a few verses later. He creates mankind, and he says he created them in his image, like him. But we are created as a reflection. We're not God. We don't have his power. We don't have his wisdom. But we have some of his characteristics. And I think one of those characteristics is that we too, although many of you don't admit it anymore, are creative. We can design, we can build, we can cultivate, we can whatever, many different areas. Like, we can create beauty. And so we get to Genesis 2:15. All right, that's kind of the theme verse for this series that we've been walking over the last 3 or 4 weeks, where he builds this garden, the Garden of Eden. By the way, Eden means pleasure, delight, like this place of like trees and flourishing and it is the greatest place that has ever existed until we get to heaven, all right? And it's probably going to be like Eden. And so God put Adam and Eve in this place of pleasure to cultivate and guard it. Now, I love that about God. I love that when he created us, he designed us for a purpose. And that purpose was not just to be a robot, but it was to create, to build, to cultivate, to design, to organize, to put flowers together, to put trees together, put taste together, to cook, and all the other build a city. But whatever it is, like we have this freedom in Christ to be cultivators. And this whole series is about being God-honoring, kingdom-building cultivators, that we are called to cultivate the kingdom in this area. We have over the last 15 years. It's what we've attempted to do. And the last 15 years are really foundational. It's the building blocks for what we want to do next. And so, you know, you ever watch a TV show and they go through, like they go rewind, like this is what's happened so you don't miss anything? Well, let me just do that real quick, all right? We are supposed to be cultivating our soul. At the heart of our impact is our soul. It's us. And so when Christ came, he came to change us. We're not just not doers, we're also human beings. Like he wants to transform us. He wants to bring healing to our life. He wants to make us who he like him. He is transforming us. Now there's a biblical word for that. We call it sanctification, big word, which means we're being changed to become more and more and more like him. And so we need to be partnering with our Father in cultivating our soul. If we have a healthy soul, if we're connected well to the Father, we will bear much fruit. That's what the Bible says. Now, if we are not connected to the vine, if we aren't like cultivating our soul, the fruit we produce will tend to rot on the vine, all right? Apart from me, you can do nothing. So we need to be cultivating our soul. We also need to be cultivating a relationship. Like we were designed to not be alone. We're designed to do church, not by organizationally, but church by its, even by its Greek definition, is an assembly. It's a gathering of family. It's a gathering of us. It's a gathering of people. So we want to be the church relationally, by the way, which we talked about, that command, love one another, right? We use that all the time. And at the foundation of love is humility. And if we want to cultivate something incredible in a church, in a family, in this environment, we need to walk into this place in humility. Humility is laying aside our pride, laying aside what we want, laying aside, we're looking out for the best interests of others. And remember John 13, he says, Jesus showed them the full extent of his love by washing his disciples' feet. Now, we're not going to that whole message again, but I just think the opposite of love, or what the opposite of love is pride, and also the opposite of pride is humility. And so we want to be walking in humility and relationship with each other. And then we talked about last week, we had some people sharing stories and sharing what we're focused on, and this is coming from Matthew 28, that we go make disciples. We want to be a church and be people who are investing in other people so they can become more and more like Christ. All right. So this morning, I want to go a little further. As we are being a disciple of Christ, and Christ is working in our life, there is a byproduct of that. We're going to be, okay, let's go to Ephesians so you can see this. All right, I'm going to read this first section, and this is not the part of the message yet. I mean, it is, but it's not the focus, but this is the context of what Paul is writing to the church. And we would call this, by the way, the gospel, what we're going to read right here. As for you, that's us, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air. All of us, and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, and the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving wrath. So right there, you can pause. That's the initial context of our lives, that we were in rebellion against God. And because of that, we deserved his wrath, being separated from him. We were enslaved. We were trapped. But okay, listen, that's not done. Don't lose me yet. That's part of the gospel of knowing who we were. But verse 4 says this, but, and I always look for the small words in Scripture, but because of his great love for us, because he loved us so much, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. It is by grace you've been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. Now, two verses that are packed full of things that I wish I could spend time and draw out, but just understand that he took us from being dead in our transgression and sins, to being in the highest place with Christ, where we are going to experience his grace over and over and over again forever. His incomparable riches of his grace. Like, you can't even compare what that... We went from the lowest of lows to the highest of highs. Why? Because of his great love for us. Right? He wants to transform us for those who are in Christ. Verse 8 and 9. Again, these are very popular verses that you may have heard. If not, read them like you would for the first time. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves, it is a gift of God. Not by works, so that no one can boast. All right, Paul's like, listen, your rescue from death and our transgressions and sins to the highest of highs, having the incomparable riches of Christ being poured out on you, is not because of anything we do. It is not by works, so that you and I cannot boast. You cannot go to church enough to receive that grace. You can't be a good enough person. You can't walk on enough people across the street. You can't give enough. There is nothing we can do to earn his grace. What it is it's a gift that we live in. And you might, again, if you study this, and I hope that you do sometime, look at all the times it's mentioned with Christ. It's like when we are identified with Christ, when we're in relationship with Christ, we get to experience all those things. An inheritance that doesn't fade. Hope that lasts. And so many, and it's a gift. We haven't earned to be part of that. He has offered it to us. And he's like, don't boast about your rescue and your salvation because I've given it to you. But he's not done. The storyline of this is not over. This is where we're landing this morning, is verse 10. Four. All right, connection, right? That's another small word. It connects to the last segment because of all that he's just said, because of that rescue, the gospel, the good news that's working out in our life, that he has transformed us from like lost to found, from blind to seeing, from broken to healed. And you can go on and on. I was, but I am. He says, for we are God's handiwork. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, right? He's creative. He has built the world. He has put all the foundations in place. Every place that we look, we see his creativity on display, right? I mean, he is a creative God. He is so amazing. I mean, think about the amazing things of, like, even snowflakes. Like, don't they say there's no two snowflakes alike? Like fingerprints, no two fingerprints are really alike. Like the creativity in the small and the creativity in the big, and even like this is what I love. All right, you can tell I get excited when I talk about God's creativity. I can go to the Adirondacks, four different seasons, and probably multiple times during those seasons, stand at the same high peak and get multiple experiences of God's creativity. Isn't that not true? Like, the fall, right now, you go to the Adirondacks someplace, even here, you're like, get the fall picture. You get the summer picture. You get the winter, the snow, and you get the sensory feel, too, when you're up there, the snowfall and the coldness of it, right? You get the full, God is not just creative in one aspect. He creates, like, movements in the midst of that. And think about this. He created music. If you're ever a lover of music, there is, by the way, science to music. There's like reality to music. It's just not creative, but there's creativity in the art of music, and we get to enjoy all forms of music. And so you're like, you're getting off course. I am getting a little off course, but let me go back. We are God's handiwork. As much as he created those things, in fact, some would say, and I would say, that his work now in us is one of his greatest things that he's showing off. Like, he is working on us. And I there's a couple things I wanted to point out here. One is, we are God's. I mean, we can stop there. I know there's more to that section, but we are like the raw material in his hands. Right? We are the clay. Maybe we're the canvas. Maybe we're a blank piece of paper for him. But when we put ourselves underneath his authority, he does the artwork, right? He takes the raw material of who we are, which he created, by the way, and he starts putting pieces together and doing things in our life that are going to be amazing and beautiful and honoring him. And we're a reflection of his glory too. Glory means beauty. Glory means like standing apart. And we are supposed to be a reflection of that glory. Like, so when people see what God is doing in our life, it should be like, wow, only God could do that. And what I love about God's handiwork, by the way, going back to his diversity, is every one of us is so different. And so, like he has a way of taking every person in here and using their exact personality. And we'll get into this a little bit more, but it's like God has a design, not just in a generality of like everyone's going to look the same, but the diversity of that creativity of God. And then how he puts that creativity individually together for a beautiful picture of a mosaic. We are God's handiwork. We are his piece of art and the treasure that he's building something. He's drawn something. And listen, when you look at your life, this is maybe where something that you need to hear this morning. You're looking at what is happening right now, or maybe even looking at yourself right now and thinking that it's all falling apart and breaking apart. Maybe we need to hang on to this verse a little bit longer and saying, maybe, one, God knows what he's doing. Two, maybe the very things that we're frustrated at are the very things that he uses to shape us into the handiwork that he wants us to be. Johnny Erickson Tata, I'm not sure if you're familiar with that name. She, I think she dove off a pier, lost the use of her body, her legs, and so for basically her whole life, she couldn't walk and she was in a wheelchair, and yet she tells, she writes some books and did a lot of artwork, but she's like, all those things that I thought were ugly were ways to shape me into the beautiful creation that he desired me to be. Like, he's doing the work. Listen, what I'm going to tell you is, when you're the clay, cutting pieces off of clay is not necessarily, I mean, I'm guessing it's not, it's got to be, I mean, clay doesn't feel, but cutting away is not easy. Like, when you're pruning a tree, you have to cut some things away. God's going to have to, you know, when you learn our one word, He's going to have to put some things in your life so you can actually learn it. And so God's doing work. Go back to the verse again. Put it up there on the screen for me. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus. We are in Christ. We are connected to him. And so when we accept Christ as our Lord and Savior, we step into that relationship. We are created anew. We are a new creation in him, and that's the start of his work that he is doing in our life. And what he is creating us to do is good works. The outcome of what he's doing is transforming us, and then out of that transformation of us, we will do good works. We will cultivate the kingdom wherever he has placed us. There, let me put it this way. There is something, and there might be multiple somethings, that he has designed you uniquely to do. He has put you in certain places uniquely for you. He has given you certain personality that are unique to you. And he's like putting you in a place where you can cultivate the kingdom. Now, let me talk about that a little bit. Jesus came, right? He preached the kingdom. You know, he preached. But that's not all he did. He also healed, obviously. He fed 5,000. He touched lepers. He ate with tax collectors and sinners. There were lots of ways he cultivated the kingdom. He wanted people to experience the gospel, the good news. But in the baseline of that, he was doing these other things to create the kingdom, the look of the kingdom. Does that make sense this morning? Like, you are designed to build the kingdom. How do I say this right? If you're looking for the church as an organization to the being the main way that he has cultivated the kingdom, your picture is not correct. Does that make sense? Like, we are an organization. We are a family, but it's by the individuals of the family stepping into their unique design that God kind of cultivates his kingdom in every nook and cranny of society. Since he does not want to keep the kingdom here, he wants everyone in this world, in our community, to experience the glory of his kingdom, his reign, his goodness, his flourishing, the way he works in people's lives. He wants every little dark area, every little place in our culture, he wants to bring that kingdom everywhere. And the way he does that is he prepares us, he creates us to do good works. That word good is like set apart, like different. It's like going back to the garden again when he says, it is good, it is good, it is good. You remember that whole he's creating. He's like, man, this I want them to do good works, like things that will have kingdom impact. And let me just, you're like, well, how do I figure what God, we might call it calling. I call it unique design. How do we figure out what God has uniquely designed you to do? Well, I'll give you a couple things. One is you have a personality. Well, I'm hoping you have a personality. And you can go different ways with this, right? There's Enneagram. Are you familiar with Enneagram? Some of you have no idea what it is. You have a certain Enneagram type. You have a certain Myers-Briggs temperament. You have a certain DISC analysis. There is a way that God has knit you together. You might be outgoing. You might be quiet. You might be like task-oriented. You might be like people-oriented. But there is a design for you. And because of the uniqueness of that, there's a way that God wants to use your personality where you are. And so you have to pay attention to how has God created you, your personality. What experiences has God put in your life? Rick Warren says this, God never wastes an experience. God uses experience to cultivate his kingdom. And so sometimes the most painful things that have happened to you become your greatest opportunities to cultivate the kingdom in someone else's life. And so you have to like figure out what, we did this in one of my classes, it's just kind of like life storying where God has brought you, the different things, good and bad, mission trip, life transforming events. If you put 10 life transforming events, both good and bad, and you start, sometimes, and a lot of times, you can see God writing a storyline in the midst of those events. So pay attention to your experiences. Your gifts and abilities, right? I mean, some of you are incredible with woodworking. Some of you should stay away from the lumberyard, right? Some of you are great at cooking. And some of you, we will not put in charge of our dinner next week, right? There are some things that you're exceptional at with your abilities and some things that you're not. And to know where your strengths are can help you cultivate the kingdom. Maybe the biggest one that I think we need to do more and more and more of as we're looking at how do we find our unique design to make the biggest impact in the kingdom is prayer. God, I know you've designed me. I'm your artwork. Open my eyes to what you want me to do. God, help me to see with kingdom eyes. Help me to see where you've placed me. Help me to step, God, just guide me in this, like stir in me something. Because I want to do what you have called me to do. And in the midst of that prayer, by the way, and in the midst of what God has placed in you, there are some things that are passionate for you. There are some things that you will get fired up about if it comes up in a conversation. There are things that will make your eyes water when you start talking about and thinking about those things. There are some things in your life that you are dead on passionate about, and there's this holy discontent that something has to be done about this. That may be the place, as you're prayerfully seeking him, that you can bring your gifting and your abilities and your experiences and who you are and your submission to Christ even, and say, all right, God, I'm stepping in because I can't not do anything because I'm about building the kingdom. And the kingdom can be be feeding the homeless and building the kingdom can be caring for orphans and bringing the kingdom can be like serving someplace. It can show up in so many different ways. Why? And I think in the diversity of this room, how many passions are here that if we just stirred a little bit more and stepped a little bit more, rather than Facebooking some article about why something is wrong, we actually stepped into the actual need and the actual like thing that we can do, the good works we can do, what difference that would make for the kingdom. Because the church, by the way, has lost some credibility because we've been more about what we see, what we say, than what we do. And I just think we need to be less about what we say and more like, let's step into our passions. Be passionate about the same thing. Don't diminish your passion. But if you're passionate about abortion and about ending that, step into like working with young girls who are pregnant and investing in those girls' lives. Or adopt a kid. Or help finance the Pregnancy Resource Center, or be on their board in some way. Like, if you're passionate about something, step into it. Because we're designed for good works. Our unique design. Put the verse back up there again. Which God, okay, I'll start from the beginning. So, for we're God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Just pitch this. Do you hear that truth there? Like, before you were born, he had a picture of what your design was. In fact, I would say he put you in this small little community for a purpose, and for this season. He put you at your work for this. He had in mind what he wanted you to do well before you even thought about doing anything. Probably before you came to Christ, he knew you. In fact, the way the Greek plays out in this is, I'll probably get it a little bit wrong, but basically, which God prepared in advance for us to do, to keep walking in that way. Like, we're supposed to walk in this journey of what God has designed for us. And so, where we're going and why this is such an important piece of our church is what we are trying to do is help people not do what the church's vision is. Like, we want to do this ministry. We want to uncover people's unique design and help them step in that direction, to resource them to do what God has called them to do. I don't know if you know this, but most of the things that happen here are not because the leadership team sits down and says, hey, maybe we should do this. Most of the time, there are people that come to me and say, hey, I have this crazy idea. Can we do this? Let's try it. You know, the Alan Scott Band was here not too long ago. That wasn't a church, like, meeting thing of, like, what should we do now? That was someone who had an idea and said, let's try this. We have another concert coming up here in a few weeks. That was a different person who says, hey, I have a crazy idea. Let's try it. We have different ministries that have started. There's it's called the Heroes Ministry that is building, that's focused on taking kids who have special needs and making them, discipling them and helping them serve in their unique design and being part of the family of God. So there's that piece. And there's all these different pieces of the kingdom that have been built because someone had a crazy idea that was in their unique design. And I should probably just say this too. Sometimes you look at yourself and you have a crazy idea and you're like, I'm sure there's a better leader for that, right? That's not my design. That's not really what I'm good at. Sometimes I think we just have to step and see what God does with it. Not everything is big, and very few things start big. I'm not saying you can't dream big, but what I'm saying is all we do sometimes is take one step. What's the next natural step to lean into your unique design? And think about all the places where the kingdom can be built if people did that. And sometimes we just think like ministry and church world. What if you use that for, if you're an entrepreneur in here, like you're like starting a business or you want to start a business. How do you make that your unique design, and how do you cultivate the kingdom because of that business? How do you live your business to cultivate the kingdom? Or maybe you work for some organization or some Corning Incorporated or the hospital or the schools, and you're like placed in a position, and you're like, all right, God, I'm here. How do I live out my unique design where I am? How do I bring the kingdom here in the way that I can? How do I create a culture in my classroom that will bring glory to you, even though I might not be able to mention God like I want to, but I need to cultivate the kingdom. And by the way, the cultivating the kingdom for a classroom could be like noticing the one kid who has behavioral issues who is coming from a rough background, and you build a relationship. Do you understand what I'm saying? There is so much diversity in the way we can build the kingdom. We can cultivate the kingdom. And what we want to do as a church is to a fan and a flame. You ever start a fire? It smokes all the time. Like, you can't get it going. And what do you do? Or some of you are like the gas people. You're like, let's go get the gas can. That's not, some of us get down, you get down near the fire, right? And you like blow on it and blow on the embers. You familiar with what I'm talking about? Till it starts going? Some of us have this little spark that needs to be blown out a little bit more. The church, us, Higher Hope, wants to fan into flame the gift that God has given you, because by doing that, I think the kingdom is built. And the kingdom becomes so beautiful and reflects his glory, and it brings healing to our community. And it shows up in the dark places of addiction and brokenness and hurt. And it shows up in all different places of job situations. And it shows up in the gyms that we work out in. And it shows up in the sewing groups that we're in. I'm not in one, by the way, but for those that you are, you know, it shows up. It shows up in every place in your community. By the way, read Bob Goff sometime. I don't know if you're familiar with Bob Goff. In some ways that he brings the kingdom in fun ways into his community. Like, he starts parades down through the neighborhood. You know, just kind of a parade. No plan to it. But you're bringing the kingdom in all sorts of ways. A few years, I'm not a video maker, and I've never claimed to be one. That's not my gifting. But I made a video a couple years ago because I love this song. And I'll give you a little background of this song. I was at a conference really early on. My wife and I were there, and it was a church planting conference where you learn about how to start a church and how do you help churches grow and become what God has designed them to be. And part of the thing is we worship together. And I had never heard this song until that conference, and there's a few songs that had a catalytic moments for me. This is one of them, of like why we do what we do, because we want to see the kingdom brought to the city. So take a look of some of this song and also some pictures of what we've done in the last 15 years as well.
You're the God of this city. You're the King of these people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like us.
that 15 years we've been walking this journey, and I still believe that thought of there are greater things to be done in our community going forward than what we are celebrating going back. And so the question doesn't become, what do we do as a church? The question is, how does our church help you do what God has called you to do? How do we help you to find what your design is and step into a direction? How do we help resource you? We don't want to just send you. We want to help you do what God has called you to do. What financial stuff do you need? What leadership do you need to grow in? What other pieces of the adventure do you need to experience so the kingdom of God can be cultivated in the small little community of Big Flats, New York, and the surrounding areas? So as you walk away this morning, we've been talking about commitments. It's really this. What is God calling you to do, and what step do you need to take this week to make it happen? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank you that you created us uniquely, that we have a design, that we are all part of the mosaic of the kingdom that you've created. And I thank you for the work you've done in each of our lives through experiences and through transforming us through your word and through community. God, awaken us a dream, awaken in us where you want us to step. And may you do more in us than we ever thought or we could ever think or imagine. May we have more stories of celebration of ministries that are started, businesses that have been started, churches that have been launched, and people who have been impacted because of the people who stepped into their calling, who stepped into their unique design. So God, I just thank you for choosing us, even though we are weak, unable, unworthy at times, but you are still good. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, just a few things that I wanted to share with you, especially about next weekend. So next weekend, we're wrapping this series up, but we're in the morning, Sunday morning. I want to invite you back because that's really going to be the culmination of the series. It's kind of like a vision Sunday. I'm going to cast vision of where we're going over the next 5 years, and so want you to be part of that. And so that'll be in the morning. And in the evening, we're going to have a dinner at 5 p.m. Here. And we'll be eating together. And then we're going to have some celebration, some story, storytelling, some testimonies of what God's doing in people's lives. And then we have some special kind of ways that we can commemorate the last 15 years and really the commitment to where we're going over the next 5, 10 years as well. And so we're excited about next Sunday night. I want to invite you to that. I think you can bring a dish to pass, dessert, or a side dish, and we'll have the meats and all the other stuff as well. A few other things. Next Friday night, we're having another hang, which is out in the pavilion, and we have the lights set up, and you can see the pictures on Facebook of that. But just want to invite you to come, hang out together, build relationship. Friday night, I think it's at 7 p.m., and so feel free to come to that. Also coming up, another way to connect on this coming Saturday from 6 to 8 is a crafting connection. We have a lot of people who have different crafting skills, and so they'll be meeting here. You can bring your project that you're working on and be part of just hanging out together as you work on that project. If you're in 6th to 12th grade or have someone in your family that's in 6th to 12th grade, we do have a retreat coming up at La Mocha. It'll be Friday, November 12th and the 13th, $40 per student. You need to sign up by November 5th if you're interested in going to that. A couple other things. One of the things that we do here at Higher Hope as a way to cultivate the kingdom is we have different projects every month. And this month's project is to be able to provide some supplies to the local schools. And so you can bring in crayons, pencils, paper, notebooks. There's a long list of things that you can bring in. There's a basket in the entryway that you can put it in, but we are going to give those to the local schools here in a few weeks. The last thing, just from the church side, we are looking for someone to plow snow here because snow is eventually coming. And so if you have someone or you are someone who has a business that way, please let us know. We'll kind of get a hold of you and talk you through what we're looking for, and then you can tell us what the details are for you. And we're also looking for someone who would be willing to volunteer in shampooing the rugs as well. I think that's all I have for you. Thanks for worshiping with us, and we hope to see you next week. And just cultivate the kingdom this week.